If you've seen my previous videos on weaving baskets in Blender, you might think the geometry nodes would be a great way to create a texture like this. But the truth is, all of that geometry requires a lot of memory, which is going to put a lot of strain on your computer when you go to render out the final result. So today, I'm going to show you a much better approach to woven textures like this one. Hopefully by the end of this video, you'll pick up some techniques that you can use on your next project, but at the very least, you'll have a pretty versatile node group that you can use on a number of other materials. So let's get started. Let's switch over to our shading workspace, switch to the rendered view, and get rid of our default cube and bring in a mesh plane. Drag this up here so you can see better. And we're gonna switch to top view. Start a new material. I'm gonna bring in a texture coordinate, and we're gonna use the UV coordinates for this. So I'll take our UV to a scale node, and then this is gonna be a repeating pattern. So we'll go to a fraction node, we'll shift click on that. So you can see we change this to 2, we're going to get 2 repeats across that, change this back to 1. Now before we go any further, I just want to take a look at the node group that we're trying to create, because I think it's going to be a lot easier to follow what's going on once we take a look at that. You can see the inputs over here, we've got the width, which is going to control the overall width of that woven section. We've got our coverage, which is going to influence how much of that area is covered by the strips, and our count, which is obviously going to control how many of those strips we have. And the outputs, this is a height map, which is what you're seeing there. We also have a coordinate system, which we're going to use for texturing these, and a position, which we're going to use to identify each one of those strips. Now, the first step to this process is just going to be to create a coordinate system, and those coordinates are going to go from 0.5 over here to 1 at the center of the first strip, 2 at the center of the second, 3 at the center of the third, and then 3.5 at the far point. And it's going to be the same for the y-axis. And also, if we change the count, it's going to change from 0.5 to 1 to 2 to 2.5 at the end. So with that in mind, let's hit Ctrl-G on this fraction node and go into the node group. I'm going to drag our output over here, drag our input over, bring out the side panel. I'm going to add in our inputs here. So our first input will be our width. We're going to leave that as a float, and we're going to change the subtype to factor. That's going to go from 0 up to 1, and then let's add in another. We're going to do coverage. That's also going to be a float, and we're going to make this a factor as well. This one we're going to go from 0.001 up to 0.99. That's just because 0 and 1 are going to screw up the map somewhere in this node group. We'll do one more input, that'll be our count. And ideally this would be an integer, but there's no integer type here. So we're gonna leave that as float with none as the subtype, but we will change this minimum to 1. Now the next thing we're gonna do, we need to find the width from the center point of that left strip to the center point of the right strip. So to do that, bring in a truncate node, and then we can subtract 1 from that because we're subtracting half of a strip from either side. So we'll change this to 1, and then we can divide that by our original count. Now we can take our width and multiply that by the factor that we just created. Now we basically want to find where each of those center points is relative to the halfway point. So we're going to divide this by 2, and then we're going to take that and subtract it from 0.5. Make sure you switch this so you're subtracting from 0.5, and then we can add this 2.5. Now we're going to bring in a series of map range nodes. So let's connect our first map range. And this map range is going to go from 0 to our first center point. And we want that to go from 0.5 up to 1. Duplicate this map range. And this one is going to go from our first center point. Connect this vector. We'll go from our first center point to our second center point. And this one we want to go from 0 to our count minus 1. And we're going to add that on top of this, so it's going to be 100. So then we'll duplicate this one more time, connect our input vector. And this one is going to go from our second center point to 1. And we need this to go from 0 up to 0.5. Now we just need to add these map ranges together. So I'm going to add our top map range to our bottom map range. And then we need these to increment up 1 every time this pattern repeats. So to do that, I'm going to bring in our group input again. We're going to take this vector to a floor node. We can take our count to a truncate and multiply these two together. and that will step up by one every time the pattern repeats. So we'll take this, add it to our middle map range, and then we will add that to the other two map ranges. And that should give us our coordinate system. Just so we can see what that looks like, bring in a separate XYZ node, and we'll bring in a map node. Set this to snap, and I'm going to change this increment to 1. And then just so this is easier to see, let's bring in a white noise texture. And I'm going to tab back out of our node group. All these defaulted to 0, so I'm going to switch our width to 0.4. Our coverage isn't hooked up yet, but I'm going to set that to 0.8. We're going to use that later. And our count, I'll just change to 3. So now you can see we've got our 3 center points marked out here, and we're going from 0.5 at this side to 1, 2, 3, and then up to 3.5. And at this point, we can change our count, and we can also change our width. So let's tab back into our node group. I'm going to get rid of these 3. Then we can take all of this, put that in a frame, and I'm going to rename that to coordinates. Now we can take the coordinates that we created and turn that into a height map. We're going to take the output from our coordinates down to a scale node, and we're going to multiply our coordinates by pi, and then connect that to a cosine node. And that's just giving us a smooth cosine wave, but we need to flip alternating strips. And we're going to do that by using the sine from our x and y coordinates. So whenever x is positive, we're going to flip y. Whenever y is negative, we're going to flip x. So we can take our cosine to a separate xyz node, take our x, connect that to a sine, and we will also take our y to a sine node. And then we're going to take the sine from our y and connect that to a combined xyz node. We need to make sure that we're connected to it. The x input, then we're going to take the x and connect that to the y input. Take this to a multiply node. We'll multiply x by 1 and y by negative 1. Then we can take the output from our cosine node. Over here, we'll go to a multiply node and connect that up. And that's giving us this red is our x going positive, negative, positive. And the green is our y coordinate going positive, negative, positive. But we don't actually want that to go negative. So we're just going to take this to another map range. We just flip this from min from 0 to negative 1. Instead of going from negative 1 to 1, we just have our cosine wave moving between 0 and 1. It just doesn't look quite as nice. So now we can take all of this, control J, and we'll call that height. The next thing we need to do is isolate our strips and create a mask for our height map. So I'm just going to go up here and bring in a group input, and we need to find the start and end of our woven section. So I'm going to connect our width, we'll divide that by 2, and then we can subtract that from 0.5 and also add it to 0.5. Then we're going to take our incoming vector to a fraction node, and we'll connect that to a map range. Now we can use the start of our woven section as our from min and the end of our woven section as the from max. And we'll take our count through a truncate node and use that as the to max. Now if we connect this map range output to a fraction node, you can see we've got our strips isolated, but now we just need to be able to control the width of each one of those strips. So we're going to take our coverage, we will divide that by 2. And then I'm just going to copy this add and subtract node, Shift D, bring that over here, and we will subtract this from 0.5, add it to 0.5, and then we'll just duplicate this map range and use the start of our strip as the from min, the end of our strip as the from max, and we're going to have those go from 0 to 1. Now we can connect this to a separate XYZ, and I'll take our X to a compare node. Now, if you get to this point and everything up here is white, that's because this map range is going from 0 to 1. And because it's clamped, everything 0 and below is just equal to 0. Everything 1 and above is just equal to 1. So this compare node is finding everything. So we just need to unclamp that. And then we can take our Y to another compare node. And this is another instance where we need to swap our X and Y coordinates. We're going to take our Y to the X input on a combined XYZ and then connect our X to the Y input. And then we can take the output from that to a multiply node and then connect the output from our height to the other side of that multiply node. And now we have our height map isolated to just where those strips are. So I'll just take everything up here, control J, and we'll call that mask. At this point, we almost have our height map calculated. All we need to do now is combine our X and Y coordinates to create a single value for our height map. So I'm going to take our vector here to a separate XYZ node. We're going to connect our X to a maximum node and connect our Y to the other side of that maximum node. And that actually gives us our finalized height map. We're going to take that and connect it to our group output, bring out our side panel, and I'm going to rename this to height, also drag that to the top. The next thing we want to calculate is our coordinates. And to do that, we're going to start with this separate XYZ in our mask setup. You can see this is already giving us 0 to 1 across each one of those strips. So I'm going to drag our X up here to a combined XYZ, and we'll also connect our Y to a separate combined XYZ, making sure that we're connected to the X input. Bring in another group input, and we'll take our vector to a separate XYZ, and I'm going to connect our X to the Y on our second combine, our Y to the Y on our first combine XYZ. And then we'll take this to a vector mix node, connect this one to the other side of that. And this is just allowing us to control with that factor, which one of those vectors we're looking at. We're gonna take this mix node, we'll go down here. And for that factor, all we need is a greater than node. And we'll connect the Y to the other side of that. So now wherever X is greater than Y, we're gonna use A. Wherever Y is greater than X, we're gonna use B. But we do need to isolate the coordinates to where our strips actually are. So to do that, we're just going to take our maximum. We'll connect that to another greater than node and just check where that's greater than 0. You can see that just isolates to where our strips are. So we'll take our mix node, connect that to a scale node and connect that up. And that's going to give us our coordinates where those strips are. So we can take this and connect it to our vector here. And I'm just going to rename that to coordinates. And the last thing we need to find is the position, because we need to be able to know which one of these strips we're looking at any given time. And to do that, we're going to start with this add node back in our original coordinates. This is the coordinates for the center section, and it's going to be increased by 1 each time the overall pattern repeats. But keep in mind, this is actually hitting the center point of each one of those strips. So we actually need to add 0.5 to our coordinates. So we're going to take this to an add node, and we're going to add 0.5 to our X and Y coordinates. I'm just going to drag this over here. We're going to take this to a floor node, and then we can take that to a separate XYZ. Now we can do something similar to what we did below. We're going to take our X to a mix node, connect our Y to the other side of that. And again, this is allowing us to switch back and forth between those. We can take this mix, put it right above our previous mix node. Then we'll use the same greater than node as the factor here. And we can take this to a multiply and connect our greater than to that. And now we have our position isolated to each one of those strips. So now we can take that to our final output, and we will call that position. We tab out now. You can see we've got our finalized node group. If I take this scale up to 4, we can change our width and cover everything. We can also bring our coverage up or make the strips thinner. And we can also increase the count and increase the number of strips in each one of those sections. Next time, I'm going to show you how to take the node group that we just created and turn it into this amazing 6-way woven rattan texture. So be sure to like and subscribe so you don't miss out on that. If you enjoyed this tutorial and you're looking to take weaving into the third dimension, then you should definitely check out this tutorial on weaving baskets with geometry nodes.